This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Welcome to The Doctor Is In with me, Dr. Dinothra Archer Cartwright. I am a family medicine specialist, and we're here every Tuesday night on Guardian Radio talking all things health, wellness, and things that pertain to the Bahamian society. I want to thank you, brought to you, of course, tonight by Medical Concierge Services for all your medical healthcare needs. Our primary care clinic is located in the Bahamas Heart Center on the second floor. And you can reach us 326-1521 or WhatsApp 432-4010. If you want to join NHI or if you just want to come and see us and make an appointment, you can reach out to us both ways. We're also online, so you can find us on Facebook, Medical Concierge Services, as well as Instagram, medical_services. Our website, www.mcsfamilymedicine.com. And you can find out more information about the interesting things that we do. So we don't just do primary care, which is adult, infant immunizations. We also do home care services. So we are the number one company for home care. So if you need us to come to you, we can, wherever you are. We're also developing a few other services that we're going to find about out in the next few months. So stay tuned and check out our Facebook page to keep up with us. Just like it. You know, and of course, The Doctor Is In. We're also live on Facebook, The Doctor Is In with me, Dr. D. Archer. So if you want to listen live in the evenings, on Tuesday evenings, you can do so. So tonight's topic is kind of close to my thoughts and understanding. And so I thought I would do this topic as I explore this myself. And so tonight's topic is really about fasting. And I really wanted to look at that because kind of we always hear about or kind of talk about fasting in relation to religion and prayer. And we know that fasting can restore your strength and your intimacy with God. That's a lot of what religious people use it for. And many Christians use fasting, as well as a lot of other religions, use fasting as a way for them to reconnect with God and to really humble themselves in the sight of God. Psalms 35:13 says, and Ezra 8:12, King David said, I humble my soul with fasting. So fasting is something that's been around for a very long time. It's been something that has been used both in religious and non-religious aspects. And so we're going to talk a little bit about what are the health links or benefits. We touched on fasting a little bit when we talked a little while back about intermittent fasting, but we're really going to go into different types of fasting can do from us from a health perspective. And so people are looking for different alternatives before jumping into medication and different things. So we like to explore these things because healthcare is both a spiritual and a physical thing in my thoughts. And so in order to heal people, you have to heal them in a well-rounded manner. We're also going to open the phone lines because I know sometimes I open them a little bit late. And so I'm open to other topics as well tonight and social topics as well. But as we go along, we're going to really talk about fasting and how fasting can be a really good thing for your health and actually help to reverse and change some chronic disease issues. So our phone line tonight, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Has fasting impacted you in your health in any particular question? Or if you have a question in particular, we could talk about it. But we're going to start off really talking about how fasting impacts you from a health perspective. And I think that's really important. So first, I'm going to look at an article that outlines maybe the top eight benefits that are backed by actual science. So not just anecdotal information, but what have the scientists, what have the doctors found out about fasting in relation to our health? And what they find is that there are really several benefits, including weight loss, improved blood sugar control, decrease in inflammation, and offering protection from certain cancers and different neurodegenerative disorders, all related to fasting. So yes, you can fast for your health. It's not just a spiritual thing. It does other things, and it does logical changes to our own bodies. And so it's really gone back through many cultures and many religions. And we define fasting as the absence from all or some foods or drinks for a set period of time. And there may be different ways of fasting. And in general, we consider most fasting to be between 24 to 72 hours. What most people would identify as fasting today is intermittent fasting, which may be only a few hours in the day. But technically, when we think about fasting, we think about it in 24 to 72 hour periods. Some people may be able to go longer, but then you really have to look at how that affects you as an individual, depending on what you want. I want to say early on, though, that fasting is something that may not be for everyone. It really depends on your health and your condition and your stability. Diseases like diabetes or elderly people or children really should have that sit-down conversation with their physician to see if that is even right for them. So I do advise that you talk to your doctor so that you can integrate whatever issues that you may have or your specific conditions into whatever treatments that you want to add to your plan. But of course, we know about the 24 to 72 hour fasting and then intermittent fasting, as I talked about, which is more of a cyclic period between eating where you fast and then you rest away from eating. And that can happen for a few hours or even a few days at a time. So fasting is shown to have all these benefits, increase weight loss, to better brain function. And we're going to talk about the top eight ones that are really backed by science, because we like to be science-based in a lot of different things in that. Okay, so that's what we're going to look at tonight. And you're free to call, make any comments, suggestions, or questions that you would like. We've opened the phone lines. So number one on the list of, before I get to that, I actually wanted to talk a little bit about the science of fasting and then kind of quickly get back into the benefits. And because I thought it would be important to kind of know the mechanisms in which that really happens. So what really happens when you're fasting is, I just like a little side topic to go into before we talk about the benefits. So your body really tries to adapt to whatever is going on. And anytime you go without food in your body, several changes happen in response. And so what happens is there's a change in the energy source. So your body uses compounds like food to draw energy into your body to use for your different cells. It's broken down into different things. And so you break down these carbohydrates into more simple molecules that can be used by the body. And that's really your body's main source of energy. So whatever isn't used gets stored in your liver, or it gets turned into fatty acids in your fat cells. That's why if you eat too much carbs, you end up with more fat, because the carbs are for your energy, but the rest of it, if you have too much, it's going to be stored. So for the first few hours, if you're not eating, your body tends to start pulls from stores for energy. So instead of pulling from the carbohydrates that will be coming from your food, it goes to its storage bin and it starts drawing energy there. But as these stores eventually run out, the body needs a different source of fuel. And this is known as the metabolic switch. So when glucose is no longer available, glucose like what we call sugar, your body breaks down the body fat, and that turns into ketones. Next, they are transported through your cells and use this energy. And so that's where the idea of ketosis and the ketogenic diet comes from, because they feel like if you're not eating specific things like carbohydrates, then the source of fat change, the source of energy changes, and you break down more fat. So that starts to be used, and you end up with ketones in your blood, and you can also go into ketosis. But you can see it's kind of much energy used with that last meal was, and the amount of stored glycogen in your liver. The switch can take place anywhere between 12 to 36 hours. So if you go 12 to 36 hours without food, your body is going to look for another source of energy, and that is where when that happens. As you repeatedly go without food, your cells undergo a coordinated response to that stress, and that fasting exposes to them. And this is the stress resistance. Scientists believe that this adaptive response allows your cells to improve their resistance to stress and disease. And the most relevant research stems from animal and study cells. We do feel like this is also what human beings go through. So because of the constant fasting, your body actually becomes very adaptive to being able to deal with stress, and stress becomes less of a risk factor. And then there's this idea of autophagy, which means self-eating is a process of your cells basically cleaning out and recycling all the old and damaged ones or abnormal proteins and cell components. Researchers feel like the cells become more resilient when faced with stress through autophagy. And so you have like a better self-replacement system in a sense. This process is really, really important in maintaining your healthy cells and plays a key role in preventing diseases such as heart disease, diabetes, cancer, and infections. If that process doesn't work properly, it can be very harmful to cells. And this is what really links heart disease and health problems to kind of this inflammatory process. So fasting may be able to enhance autophagy, and it could be a simple way of doing that. Evidence comes from animal studies and not really human studies. There also are some transitions or changes in our gut. Our gut health, because we know the gut is related to a lot of chronic disease, and the bacteria and microorganisms collectively known as your gut biome also affects your overall health. So evidence suggests that some forms of fasting may actually benefit your gut biome. And studies involving men who fasted for 16 hours a day found that participants had more beneficial bacteria in their gut biomes. And this bacteria was linked to a variety of benefits, including better metabolic health, improved heart health, and lower risks of obesity. And so there are also some long-term effects, such as studies that they looked at understanding the effects of fasting over months, and doing more long-term studies, and recent evidence has shown that forms of fasting may benefit your health over time, as well as some of the other things that we're going to go into. So then now we're going to switch a little bit into what specifically those top eight benefits would be, and how we can use fasting as a way to deter chronic disease. All right. So number one on that list would be the promotion of promoting blood sugar control and reducing insulin resistance. So if you listen to any of our past shows on diabetes, we've talked about insulin resistance before and how this is a process of leading to diabetes because we need insulin to process the sugar in our body. And once we have that resistance, now we have elevated amount of sugar that's in our body. So several studies have found that fasting may improve blood sugar control, which could be very helpful for those who are at risk for diabetes. And so for a lot of my patients, if they are pre-diabetic, we do a regimen to try to keep them from off of being diabetes. This can be one of the things that are added into as well as our healthy lifestyle program. So in fact, when they looked at a very small study looking at 10 individuals with type 2 diabetes, It showed that a short-term intermittent fasting significantly decreased their blood sugar. Of course, you're not eating, so you would expect that to be true. The only thing I would say with intermittent fasting, because I've tried it myself, is if you aren't used to fasting, and once you break that intermittent fast, you want to eat the type of foods that are going to be really good for you, or what you could be doing is just piling on a lot of junk. So you have to really kind of... In 2014, they reviewed both intermittent fasting and alternate day fasting, which are like the two different types. So you have the intermittent fasting and alternate day fasting, where people would fast on different days. So they would eat normally and then fast on one day and then back and forth. And what they found is that it was very effective in limiting calorie intake and reducing insulin resistance. So when done properly, is really, really effective. And the decreasing insulin resistance basically led the body's sensitivity to insulin and allowing for the transport of glucose from your bloodstream to cells more efficiently. So you really use the energy in your body more efficiently. Because your insulin sensitivity is intact. Coupled with the potential blood sugar lowering effects, also help keep your blood sugar steady and prevent spikes and crashes in your blood sugar levels, which happens a lot with diabetics, especially uncontrolled diabetics. They can have really high spikes, and then they can have these lows where they're hypoglycemic. And so early on, if you can control that level, that steady state of glucose, you're probably less likely to have, impacts in your further health. So for instance, a 3-week study showed that by practicing alternate day fasting, impaired blood sugar control in women had great effects. However, they did not see similar effects in men. So to summarize that entire IDARE process, intermittent fasting and alternate day fasting can help decrease blood sugar levels and reduce insulin resistance, but may affect men and women differently. And this is why plans really have to be tailored for the patient, because due to our chronic illnesses, due to our genetic makeup, being male or female, we can have different reactions to these things. So number two on our list of science-based benefits for fasting is it promotes better health by fighting inflammation. So I talk a lot about inflammation really being the source of most chronic disease. And usually it's something that our bodies are fighting over time. And really chronic disease is the manifestation of our bodies no longer being able to deal with forms of inflammation. So while acute inflammation is a normal immune process used to fight off infections, chronic inflammation can have serious consequences for our health. What research has shown is that inflammation may be involved in the development of chronic conditions such as heart disease, cancer, and rheumatoid arthritis. So some studies have found that fast levels of inflammation and therefore promote a better and healthier body. A review of 18 different studies found that intermittent fasting could significantly reduce the level of C-reactive proteins, which are markers for inflammation. So really great review of multiple pieces of literature. And they all showed that the inflammation markers that we can read in our bodies were actually lowered due to fasting. Another small study discovered that practicing intermittent fasting for a whole year was more effective at decreasing levels of inflammation and reducing certain risk factors for heart disease compared to other control groups. More to that, just looking also at animal studies, they found that following a low-calorie diet to mimic the effects of fasting reduced levels of inflammation, which basically in the treatment of multiple sclerosis and chronic inflammatory diseases. So all of these weird and wonderful diseases that are popping up, all leading back to this whole source of inflammation. And the low-calorie diet is really what's doing it. So sometimes you don't even really have to fast. It's like, are you putting excess calories in your body? It seems like even with just lowering that, you can get really good results. Some studies have found that fasting can decrease severe markers of inflammation and may be useful in treating inflammatory conditions. When we look at number three on our list, we see the enhancement of heart health by improving blood pressure, triglycerides, and cholesterol. And so heart disease, which is considered the world and also like a leading cause of disease here in the Bahamas, accounts for an estimated 31.5% of deaths globally. So by switching up your diet and your lifestyle, it is one of the most effective ways to reduce your risk for heart disease. Research has found that by incorporating fasting into your routine may especially be beneficial when it comes to your heart health. So really great there. When we review, one review revealed that alternate day fasting could reduce the levels of total cholesterol and several risk factors for heart disease in people who were overweight compared to various control groups. Another review showed that alternate day fasting was able to significantly decrease blood pressure, as well as the levels of blood cholesterol, or LDL, which we consider the bad cholesterol in our blood. And additionally, I went back even further and looked at a study of almost 5,000 people, which associated fasting with a lower risk of coronary artery disease. So that's like the disease that causes heart attacks, as well as significantly lowering risk of diabetes, which is a major risk factor for heart disease. So fasting has been associated with lowering coronary heart disease and also may help to lower blood pressure, triglycerides, and even your cholesterol levels. That takes us to number four on our list, benefits that have been proven by science and related to fasting. So fasting may boost your brain function and may prevent neurodegenerative disorders. Now, I see a lot of patients coming in with dementia and Alzheimer's and a lot of these neurodegenerative problems. So we do have this issue in the Bahamas. So through research, it's mostly limited to animal research, but several studies have already shown that fasting could help have a powerful effect on brain health. And in 2013, a study in mice showed that practicing intermittent fasting for 11 months improved both brain function and brain structure. Other animal studies have also reported that fasting could protect brain health and increase the generation of nerve cells to help enhance cognitive function. Because fasting may also relieve inflammation, it is also neurodegenerative disorders. In particular, studies in animals suggest that fasting may protect against and improve outcomes related to conditions such as Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's. And so, like I say, I see a lot of dementia, a lot of Alzheimer's in some of our elderly population. And this can be a really debilitating disease because as you lose your memories and your mind and your ability to do a lot of things for yourself, it is just kind of really, really devastating, and it leads to a lot of other issues, and it is very problematic for the family. So it's almost like a slow death. So Alzheimer's, really, really, really nasty disease. Don't like it. When they looked at other studies to evaluate the effects of fasting on brain function in humans, and you know, still a lot more needs to be done. So, you know, as we get more information, we'll be able to use that data more and more. So animal studies show fasting could improve brain function, increase nerve synthesis, protect against neurodegenerative conditions such as Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's. Number five on our list, before we take a quick break, we can see that fasting aids, of course, as we mentioned a little bit before, in weight loss by limiting our calorie intake and boosting our metabolism. So many people, you know, when they're dieting, they may use fasting as a way to try to lose weight. And theoretically, abstaining from all or certain foods or beverages should decrease your overall caloric intake, which can lead to weight loss over time. Some researchers in animals have also found that short-term fasting may boost by increasing the levels of neurotransmitters such as norepinephrine, which could enhance weight loss. So, short bursts of fasting just allows your body to kind of catch up and boost your metabolism more so than, longer periods possibly. So in fact, one review showed that whole day fasting could reduce body weight up to 9% and significantly decrease body fat over 12 to 24 weeks. So just fasting one day, doing this alternate day fasting, it can be really, really helpful. Like I mentioned to you all, if you have some chronic disease, if you're an elderly person or a very young person, you do want to speak to your doctor about this. Another review found that intermittent fasting was actually more effective in inducing weight loss compared to conditions of calorie restriction. So actually having that period where you're just not eating worked out better even than some people who are just limiting the number of calories it has. Now, this stuff doesn't always work for everybody, so you really have to find a program and what really works for you. And that really helps when you're trying to lose weight, because there's a lot of things that intricately make up the complexity of weight loss. In addition, there's other research that has found that fasting leads to greater reductions in body fat and belly fat compared to continuous caloric restriction. And so belly fat really is the fat that we're targeting. It's the fat that we want to lose, because we realize that a lot of chronic diseases relates to how much belly fat that you may have. And so when you start adding a lot of fat around the abdomen, that does increase your risk of chronic disease. So I guess we all have to do our sit-ups, our crunches, and we have to lose that fat off our belly. And that tends to be really, really stubborn. And I think it also becomes more challenging for women to lose that weight after having children. And so you have to think about the musculature underneath there, as well as stretching in that area as well after giving birth. So fasting may increase metabolism, and it does help reduce body weight and body fat. So we are going to take a quick break here on the Doctor's Den, and we'll be right back. Like I said, the phone lines will be open. So we'll see you on our return. Good night.
Beulah gal, can you believe this? We are now the patrol queens of the neighborhood.
We now large and in charge. So we need to check out what's going on in everybody yard. What about that gun that we know that Junior and his homeboys just ran out? Can we report that too?
Of course we can.
But we could be in deep trouble if they find out.
We need to report what we see, Beulah. When you call Crime Stoppers, they just answer your call in Miami.
So then we can report everything? Guns? Where they hiding the drugs? Who shoot who? Who part of which gang? Or who disturbing the peace with the loud music and the motorcycles?
Then our neighborhood will be the best in the Bahamas, and everybody gonna want to come live here. And then our house price will go up, gal.
So what we waiting on? What's the number?
If you see something, say something. Let us all pitch in and stop the crime before it's your time. Call 328-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands, or text us through the Crack Crime Bahamas app. Stop the crime before it's your time.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The new Guardian Radio app is here. Listen live to all our Guardian Radio shows and live video stream select programs in our studio. Get information about Guardian Radio shows and our hosts. Send messages, including text, email, and even call. All from our amazing new Guardian Radio app. Download it free today in your App Store for your Apple device or Play Store for your Android device. The all-new and improved Guardian Radio app.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk,
quality.
We're back on The Doctor Is In with me, Dr. Jenothra Archer Cartwright. Tonight we are talking about fasting and how does it benefit our health. So it's beyond just spirituality, but actual health benefits related to fasting. Our line tonight, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. If you have a comment, question, or want to jump into the conversation. We were talking about the top eight benefits that are supported by literature and science, and we were on number six. And so number six in our benefits for fasting is our increased growth hormone secretion, which is vital for growth, metabolism, weight loss, and muscle strength. And so human growth, TH, is a type of protein hormone that is central to many aspects of our health. And what we find is that research shows that key hormones is involved in metabolism, weight loss, and muscle growth. And you can find this in Healthline, in the Healthline article. Several studies have found that fasting can naturally increase this hormone, HGH, levels, and that when they studied healthy adults, it showed that fasting for 24 hours significantly increased these levels. Other studies have shown that fasting for just 2 days have led to a five-fold increase in your HGH production rate. Besides that, fasting may help to maintain the steady blood sugar and insulin levels throughout the day, which may further optimize the levels of HGH. As some research have found that the insulin can also influence HGH secretions. So studies have shown that fasting can increase levels of human growth hormone, an important protein hormone that plays a role in growth, metabolism, weight loss, and muscle strength. Number seven, could fasting help with the extension of longevity? So can we live longer just by adding fasting to our regimen? And so this was a really interesting concept that I came across of how fasting relates to long life and health. And so several animal studies have shown promising results on the potential of expanding your lifespan while using the effects of fasting. In one particular study, rats that were fasting lived 28% longer and developed, they fasted 28% than rats that were given unlimited access to food. And this is so important because it shows how much food affects our health. And living in this westernized world where we have lots of access to lots of different types of food, not always maybe the best food, but lots of access to food, that can be a part of what impairs our health. So fasting allows us time for our bodies to be able to regenerate, and we can live longer and develop less disease if we go by the model seen by these mice. Other research have turned up similar findings reporting that fasting can be effective increasing longevity and delaying disease processes in our bodies. So even if you were on the road to something, this is where fasting can kind of prolong that, that you, instead of maybe at 50, you're developing heart disease and maybe 60 or 75 or later on or never at all. However, most of the research is, of course, limited to animal studies, and we really need to have further study into understanding how fasting really impacts longevity and aging in humans. Animal studies have found that fasting can delay aging and increase longevity, but we still lack enough evidence to broadly say that it does that for humans, but it's very, very promising. And so number eight, and this is probably a really big one because we do have a lot of issues with cancer, but may aid in cancer prevention. So an increase in the effectiveness of chemotherapy as well. So animals and test tube studies indicate that fasting may benefit the treatment and prevention of certain cancers. In fact, one older rat study found that alternate day fasting helped block tumor formation. Other research in test tubes that fasting could reduce tumors and increase the effectiveness of chemotherapy. Unfortunately, most of that research is actually just on the effects of forming cancer cells and animal cells. And despite these promising findings, additional studies are needed to look at how fasting may influence cancer cells. But I do know that in some cancer treatment programs, they do use healthy eating, fasting, and these different things to as an adjunct to their chemotherapy and other therapies. All right. So how do you start fasting? There are many different types of fast, making it easy to find a method that fits you. The most common would be the water fast. And I know a lot of Bahamians know about that. And that involves drinking only water for a set amount of time. Juice fasting. When I think about juice or vegetable fasting, I'm thinking really fresh, squeezed juice or vegetable drinks. Then there's, of course, intermittent fasting, which has been really, really popular, completely restricted diet for a few hours or a few days at a time, and a normal diet resumed on the other days. Then you have a partial fast, which is a restriction of certain foods and drinks, mostly limiting your processed foods, your animal products, caffeine, those types of things, maybe even alcohol. And of course, caloric restriction, which is calories are restricted for a few days. Within these categories, there can be other different types of fast. For example, intermittent fasting can be broken down into other subcategories, such as alternate day fasting, which involves eating every other day, or time restricted feeding, which entails limiting intake for just a few hours. And we talked a little bit about this when we talked about intermittent fasting and ketosis. To get started, you want to try experimenting with different types of fasting and really kind of finding out what works for you, because everything is going to be a little bit different. And then if you're not sure, or if you have a chronic disease, you want to sit down with your doctor or your nutritionist to see what and how this affects. So with everything, we have to look at the negative and the positive. So the safety and the side effects of all of this, we also have to consider that when we look at fasting as well. So despite the long list of possible benefits associated with fasting, it may not be the right choice for you specifically. And so you have to examine that and figure that out. For example, if you have diabetes, fasting can lead to spikes or crashes in your blood sugar levels, which can be really dangerous. So you do want to, if you want to do that with your doctor, something that's monitored or done properly, or it just may not be a good fit for you because of your diabetes and your insulin insensitivity. So it's really good to talk to your doctor if you have any underlying health conditions and you want to plan to fast for more than 24 hours, especially. This is important because that's kind of the time that you might get yourself in trouble. So additional fasting is not generally recommended without medical supervision for older adults, adolescents, and people who are generally already underweight. So if you're already underweight and you may have issues with malnutrition, you know, fasting may not be the thing for you. So you really want to get guidance from your doctor. If you decide to try fasting, you want to really stay well hydrated and you want to fill your diet with nutrient-dense foods during the periods that you do get to eat, so you maximize the health benefits. And that was one of the issues that I did find with like keto and intermittent fasting. You have to be careful about, ensuring that the rest of the food that you're putting into your body is pretty healthy and you're not causing any other problems. Additionally, if you're fasting for long periods of time, you wanna try to minimize the intense physical activity and you wanna get lots and lots of rest. When fasting, be sure to stay hydrated, eat nutrient-dense foods, and get plenty of rest. You want to consult a doctor, especially if you have underlying problems, and if you're planning to fast for more than 24 hours. I also found a few other things to kind of look out for when you are considering fasting or what could be considered side effects in fasting. And depending on the type of fasting that you may be doing, you want to also consider some of these things as well. So I know for sure if you're not used to fasting, some of these things may be the things that you initially encounter. And so you want to think about things like fatigue and mood changes. So if you're not eating for a stretch of time, you may feel more lethargic than normal. Your energy levels at the very beginning may be very low. You may actually be irritable. You may have difficulty concentrating. And these are common when people first start to have their fasting. And though these symptoms can improve over time, they can be frustrating. And it sometimes deters people from continuing on with their fast. Some people may encounter migraine headaches. Skipping meal is a common migraine trigger. So if you suffer from migraines, interestingly, one study involving almost 300 in migraine found that after consistent fast, such as during the month of Ramadan, these headaches may actually subside over time. So even though initially some of the fasting actually triggered a lot of these people's migraines, what they find is with continuous fasting, they actually had less of these headaches and their migraines actually went away. So, you know, sometimes it's like when you first start exercising and, you know, lactic acidosis may be building up because you're stretching muscles that you haven't been using for a long period of time. It can be painful or uncomfortable, but if you keep going, because consistency is usually key with most of these things, you will find that it no longer becomes a problem. Disordered eating. So fasting may promote a negative relationship with food for those at risk of disordered eating. Intermittent fasting in particular may be related to an increased risk of binge eating. And I talked about this. So if for some people, you know, they may not eat all day, but then they go home and then they eat everything. And so it's kind of counterproductive. So you kind of have to know yourself and know how you experience the world and how you have a relationship with food, because, you know, that cannot be the right model for you because it does lead you down the road to having a bad relationship with food. So who really should fast? Fasting, like we said, may not be appropriate for every person, but, you know, if you want to try that, then you have that conversation with your doctor. Also on the list of people who may not want to do fasting would be pregnant women, people with other disordered eating problems. We talked about the elderly, type 1 diabetics, and anyone who requires taking medication with food. So if it's going to mess with your current regimen in particular, you know, it may want to be something that you don't really do. And going without food and drink, and that contains calories. There are different types depending on how long you intend to fast. Fasting may have positive effects on your health, such as promoting healthy heart, better blood sugar control, weight loss. However, we have to consider the risks that may be involved, and these may include feeling tired and irritable, particularly when you get started, and having migraine headaches. Also, people with certain health factors have to really think about that. So if you're considering fasting, particularly prolonged fast, talk to your healthcare professional, and that should help. All right, well, we are going to take a quick break, come back, and we're going to wrap up this topic on fasting and the benefits for our health.
Can you believe this? We are now the patrol queens of the neighborhood.
We now large and in charge. So we need to check out what's going on in everybody's yard. What about that gun that we know that Junior and his homeboys just ran out? Can we report that too?
Of course we can.
But we could be in deep trouble if they find out.
We need to report what we see, Beulah. When you call Crime Stoppers, they just answer your call in Miami.
So then we can report everything? Guns? Where they hiding the drugs? Who shoot who? Who part of which gang? Or who disturbing the peace with the loud music and the motorcycles?
Then our neighborhood will be the best in the Bahamas. And everybody gonna want to come live here. And then our house price will go up, gal.
So what we waiting on? What's the number?
If you see something, let us all pitch in and stop the crime before it's your time. Call 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands. Or text us through the Crack Crime Bahamas app. Stop the crime before it's your time.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Always on the go? Miss the show? You can now listen to Guardian Radio talk shows anytime, anywhere on Spotify and YouTube by searching Guardian Radio 96.9 FM or by entering the name of your favorite show. You can also listen by logging on to guardiantalkradio.com and clicking on the podcast tab. Guardian Radio, continuing to provide you with fresh news and smart talk anywhere, anytime, all day.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
You, Dr. Denothra Archer Cartwright, thank you for joining us this Tuesday evening every 6:30 p.m. for all things health, wellness, and things that pertain to the Bahamian Society, 96.9, and of course, Guardian Radio, talkradio.com, and you can listen to us also live on Facebook, The Doctor's In with me, Dr. D. Phone lines are open, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. We're talking about fasting and how it is good for our health. We talked about the major benefits, why or who should not be fasting. And we're just, before we go, we're just going to talk about what happens if you don't eat for a day and what really happens to your body. And so if you only consume calorie-free beverages, because with most people in fasting, most people will do like a water fast. They may include tea without sugar. Some people include coffee without sugar or cream, or black coffee. Some people don't. So you'll find that most people will do just a water-based fasting and at most maybe some green tea. So over that 24-hour period, after that, you would then go back to resuming your normal intake of food for until the next fast. In addition to weight loss, intermittent fasting can have a positive effect on your metabolism, like we talked about, boost your cardiovascular health and more. And it's safe to use this approach once or twice a week to achieve your desired results. Although this technique may seem easier than cutting back on daily calories, you may find yourself quite hungry, as we talked about. And it can also cause some side effects that we talked about and complications in persons with health problems. So you should always talk to your doctor when you are doing fasting, of course. And now what happens to your body during this time what really happens? So during the first 8 hours of fasting, your body will continue to digest the last intake of the food that you're eating. And your body will use that stored glucose or energy and continue to function as if you will be eating soon. So it's just like a normal day, because you tend to eat about 8 hours between. And so you go through that normal process of digesting the food and using that energy normal. After about 8 hours without eating, your body then begins to use your stored fats for energy. Your body will continue to use that stored fat to create energy throughout the day and for the remainder of the 24 hours. Fasting that lasts more than 24 hours, you may lead to your body starting to convert some of that stored protein into energy. And that's really where the benefits that we talked about would come from. And research is really kind of going into that to see how that that affects us all. So fasting 1 or 2 days a week may be a great way to consume fewer calories over time. And you may find it easier to do this than probably just cutting back on calories every single day. The energy restriction from a 24-hour fast, however, may also benefit your metabolism and help you further with your weight loss. It can also manage your cholesterol, your sugar levels, as we discussed. And that regular intermittent fasting may improve how your body breaks down that cholesterol and the sugar. And these changes to your metabolism will help to reduce your risk of conditions such as diabetes and cardiovascular disease. It may also reduce your risk, as we talked about, of coronary artery disease. And the regular 24-hour fast may reduce the trimethylamine and oxide levels in the long term. So high levels of this compound are related to and tied to your coronary artery disease. So this may help reduce your risk. So that's what's actually happening in your body to reduce the risk of coronary artery disease. The other benefits that we talked about included reducing inflammation, reducing the risk of certain cancers, and also reducing the risk of neurological conditions like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. Frequent fasting for 24 hours at a time can lead to side effects and increase your risk of certain other complications that we talked about. And we talked about talking to your doctor, of course, and not fasting if you have certain conditions. If you're under the age of 18, if you're recovering from surgery, if you're pregnant, breastfeeding, have type 1 diabetes, or if you have some form of eating disorder. We don't think about eating disorders in the Bahamas in the case of really like a lot of anorexia and bulimia and stuff, but I think in a large sense, we're missing a lot of eating disorders in the sense of overeating. So a lot of people tend to overeat and eat because they don't need to. And so this may be one of the things that hinders a lot of people from doing well, probably from something like intermittent fasting, as we talked about, because you might actually be eating the wrong types of foods instead of actually decreasing the amount of caloric intake. And it's worth investigating our relationship with food, especially how Bahamians deal with food. We tend to really love food, but we tend to really eat a lot of food. So our calorie intake is really, really high. And, you know, you're not going to get the benefits if you're just compressing all of that, all of those calories within a smaller window. The whole thought process is that if you have a smaller window to eat, you're actually going to be eating less calories. So fasting more than twice a week may increase your risk for heart arrhythmias and hypoglycemia if you already have some of these problems. And you want to keep in mind that we really need to do a lot more research on this topic. So will drinking water during your fast help? It's important to drink lots and lots of water, more than your usual 8 glasses. Usually if you feel hungry and you drink a glass of water, that's going to help with the hunger feelings and really give your stomach something to do, I guess. So you won't be really ingesting any water from food during that time. And so your body actually needs a higher water requirement. So 8 glasses, this would be the 8 glasses that you would drink independently. And then you would also have gotten water from various foods that you would have eaten. So if you're not eating, that actually means that you need to increase the amount of water that you put into your body. And so that can be really, really a significant part of making that fast a more positive thing. So water helps your body's digestive system regulate the body's temperature. It benefits your joints, your tissues, and it will help you to feel more energized. And so people who are usually walking around in a fog, you'll find out that they're not drinking enough water in general. So if you're fasting, you have to take that in consideration and really up the amount of water that you typically drink. You should drink water as you feel thirsty throughout the day, and this amount will vary from person to person depending on your activity level, but it's important to take note of that. If we look back, on average, men should drink about 15 and a half glasses of water, and women should drink about 11 and a half glasses. This is what was in the past of water per day, some really old guidelines. And ultimately, your thirst should be your guide when it comes to water. So we say 8 glasses today. Research shows that at one point, they suggested that men do 15 and a half glasses and women do 11 and a half. So it's like a back and forth debate on how much water we really need. But, you know, some of that water does come from our food. And that's why I suggested that if you're not eating anything, you're going to need more water if you're fasting. So how do you eat? Stop eating the right way. You can form your 24-hour fast however you choose, and you have to make sure that you prepare for your fasting in advance. Fasting healthy and well-rounded meals prior to the fast will help you get through the 24-hour period. So like I said, you don't want to just be, you know, eating a bunch of junk or fast food after fasting. You want to eat healthy prior to starting your fast, do your fast, and have proper meals that are prepared afterwards. So some of the foods you should consider eating prior to your fast include foods that are rich in protein, such as nut butters and beans, dairy products that are low in fat, such as yogurts, fruits, vegetables, whole grain starches. Foods that are high in fiber will help your body and fuel you long after you've eaten. Fruits and vegetables contain the water that will give you more hydration, so you really want to have those before you get started. Drink water and other calorie-free beverages during the fast, but keep in mind that beverages with caffeine may cause you to actually lose more water. And so if you're fasting and you're drinking caffeine, you may actually have a higher water requirement due to that. And so you want to drink additional cups of water for every caffeinated beverage that you may have. And you want to continue to eat healthy after your fast is over, and you want to avoid overeating when it is time to eat again. You may want to have a small snack or eat a light meal when your fast ends to help you ease back into your regular eating routine. And so that's what we talked about, not doing the binge eating, but just having a really light meal to end your fast and then slowly getting back into your normal routine. And so you want to be cautious when you're for the first time. You want to speak with your physician before attempting it on your own. So if you need advice, you can reach out to us or your primary care doctor. And you want to have that conversation about the benefits that may be for you. Also, the risks that may be involved, and get the advice that you need. And to conduct the type of fast that's going to be healthy and safe for you as an individual. So I hope that was helpful. I thought that was a really good topic. It's coming close to, it's like Easter season coming, and I know a lot of people are going to be thinking about fasting maybe, or doing something, giving up something. They've been giving up something during the different festivals. And so, you know, be healthy, be smart, and be considerate about what you're doing. Don't put yourself into any harm. But fasting could be a great tool in your tool belt of things to get you towards the health you need. So I want to thank you all for listening in tonight on Guardian Radio with me, Dr. D. Archer. Our show, The Doctor Is In with me, Dr. D, every Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. Sorry, we have a caller. I'm sorry. Can we get you in really quick?
Yeah, Dr. D, how you doing?
Yeah, sorry about that.
That's okay. I, you know, you probably didn't know I was on the line, but I'm familiar with autophagy, et cetera, but there's a new concept. I don't know how credible it is, right? Hydrogen-infused water. But also, I wish you could do a show. I'm afraid that I started collecting rainwater and boiling it, right? Because, you know, can you just bring light to the problem of plastics, right? The bisphenol, link and anti-gonadotrophic, you know, like problems with the male body, because it's linked to BPH. And I saw it and I was upset. Toxicologists are not being honest with the public. You know, if you need someone to really get into just real effects of the plastics on the gonads, and I feel that's a problem. And then the fact that we don't have an MRI machine, it really leaves room for like. That's like not preventing diseases. Then you could be using this instead of invasive procedures, Dr. D, and save some of the people. But you see the eye op open up, right? You saw the line by the eye op, right?
Yep.
So they'll be hopping in a minute. But I know when they're hopping away from it. You see they say, Dr. D?
And I'm thinking and about fasting, okay?
Because I own fruits and vegetables all day and one cooked meal a day. I bought some okra soup. It's a small one, and I turned it into two meals. I restricted my calories while they increase in there. Give thanks.
All right, great. Thank you, 52. Yes, looking at definitely this, the exposure to polystyrenes and microplastics on impaired gonads. We can take a look at that. There are a couple of really great articles on that. There's so many things that we do to our food and our preparation and even the way that we house them that are affecting our health. It gets crazy and it gets complicated. I try to keep it simple. But yes, thank you, 52. Maybe we'll get a chance to get into that. But thank you for your call. And I want to say thank all of you for listening in tonight. And I hope this has been really helpful. So look out for your health, wellness, and we'll see you next week on The Doctor's End with me, Dr. D. Archer. Good night. Thank you.